last time I had talked about problems that I solved between 2015 and 2019. Today I'll talk about the problem which I tried to make sense of in its nonlinear alpha and didn't make much progress. Then I simplified it and 2 weeks ago I took some thought on it and got some solutions to try to make it out. But it's not even nice, let's say, not complete. So, investigation of this problem, there are many practices coming out of it. But yes, the learning is freedom. So, this is a very simple problem in one dimension. It has been studied immensely from 30. When I looked at the invitation, it was a great multiple scattering error. I thought of presenting something which has discreteness in it, as well as a nice plan for the continuous formulation, continuous limit, with the well-known problems in temperature as well as structural media, and maybe with some discrete continuous models as well. And also some multiple scattering that can be relevant to this problem. And also has some connection with the semi infinite edges that I was studying in the past in the single scattering, or let's say the standard canonical problems, counterparts, the discrete media. So this problem has a neighborhood in which many interesting problems lie. The exposure to classical problems as well as discrete problems will take some time to write down, but yes, it's in a neighborhood to be called as an archetype problem or a sort of a canonical problem, I can say. It has interesting physical effects as well. So if you remember in the 50s, if you've seen papers, there's a lot of interest on finite chains coming from crystal models as well as from quantum mechanics. And there were authors who studied effects of different biological reasons. There's a evolution of scattering practice for transformative wave formulation. So I will talk about similar problems, but for infinite chain and with perturbations which are local, and then I'll make it more compact with my final perturbation. So this is going to be a very simple one-dimensional model that I can talk about in the first part of the talk. So if I get time towards time, I might connect it to the problems I've done in the past. So I'll present some ideas. I'll try to give some details of simple calculation also. And the asymptotics which is relevant for this problem are still being worked out. So the plan is to present you this model and give you a glimpse that connects it with the work done with me as a coach and as well as myself in a flavor. Crystals have been around in the mind of scientists when you look at the case of Leonardo da Vinci and art. But yes, understanding of the crystals from mechanics, from physics, came up in the last 100 years. Problem with substrate, which again goes back to the 13th simplified volume of the dislocation for the quantum control of body. In thinking of some of the results, which are most faces that depend from that, but you have, for example, the inflator, some of the many studies, foundations. So let me start with this simple one-dimensional lattice model. I will have a single chain of particles. Each particle is interacting with its nearest neighbors to be its strings. All particles have a constant mass, it is due to the substrate. So you have your predominantly equation one system. Now on top of it, I'm going to put perturbation. So let's keep it simple. Let's think about just mass perturbation. So some particles have a different mass, and that lets you find the number of particles. You can say just n number of sites, and you can have a distance between two particles which is mass to be n, capital N. This perturbation is epsilon n, as I told you, might and this spring constant, I can just get it off and have slightly simpler expression of this equation. The path length of this lattice, you can easily calculate by substituting in thoughts similar to what you do in continuum syndrome. You have a wave which is described by a wave number C. Only one of this also conforming to the matrix communication minus identity. And we have this special relation. This gives you the relation between the wave number C and the frequency omega. Thus, for the perfect lattice, L0 without any mass perturbation. So, unit masses. You can now study the problem with periodically arranged mass perturbation. This is going to be an epsilon n, and the discretion relation drastically changes. We can derive this equation using slope theory and plot. So for example, here the solid curve for the L epsilon n. I'm just comparing with the dotted line, which is coming from the perfect lattice without any mass changes. So you can notice there are stop banks in K, which is arriving because of the periodic arrangement of masses. So here, for example, I'm equal to 2, I'm showing this schematic, and this result is 4, I'm equal to 7, that I'm showing for the discrete person curves. If K is 0, is just lattice angle, which you can say, this will be 0.0. So that will be here as well, which will pass to 0. Now I want to study a problem where there are a finite number of such to go to that point, let me also point out that if you change this mass perturbation, you can do a nice asymptotic analysis. Lots of work has been done from that point of view, how the distances change, how the goes to. More things, even going back to 1950s and 1920s. So this is just a numerical calculation. If you plot delta n with epsilon n, how we can change how the frequency is here and here change as you increase this epsilon n from 0. And as soon as you can make it. So now the scattering problem, which is assumed to disperse of mass, I have only finite number of sites n, where I will change it from 1 to 1 plus delta n. And I'm sending this incident wave from the right side. It will be in this picture coming from here. So it satisfies the equation of motion for the lattice n 0. And it's moving towards light, so you can say the distance velocity is positive. And I have this incident wave number, Cn, at the point. So, for example, in this picture, you will choose it from this point. Now you just substitute the standard wave to. There's a total field of the instant field plus the field which satisfies the dynamical different conditions like the scattered field. So U here represents the scattered field. And here is the contribution of the mass effect. It's just equal to 1 of the site that I change the mass from 1 to 1 plus 1 times. This equation can be solved by using the Green's function that I will use. The Green's function can use for a point source on a one-dimensional axis. So this equation can be solved for this. Again, there are many ways to solve it, and one can easily find that this is the expression. You can easily find it using complex analysis. If you put a little bit of damping, the imaginary part of the formula is positive, then you can assume that one of the roots of the equation, which I wrote down here, where you will have now instead of the sanctity z of the inverse, then mod z will be less than 1, and the choose will be imaginary part of the formula positive. So this equation. Now you can easily find the relation that this root is also by the choice of the relation same as for I, as it was here, right word moving. Now this function I can use to solve this problem. I write the scattered field UY in terms of the sources placed at this. Times where I have changed the and this is the Green function now written in terms of CLM, because as I said, this Green is the right. Of course, till this point, the regular arrangement of these perturbation doesn't make any difference. You can do it for any particle number of particles changing the mass. But let's try to keep things in the design, if I want to do something with. So I want to solve this kind of equation for the regular arrangement where I have m is the number of particles whose mass I have observed. And this is the unknown field for this n number of sites. So as a consequence for this solution, I can have this implicit equation for this n number of unknowns, which are the displacements of these particles. Where the mass has been changed. Now this Zn I introduce so that I can write this in a simpler manner, but it also connects the later matrices. And this coefficient is given and you can again. So going from here to here is just two things. I have recorded only for both sides where the mass has been changed, and I have just replaced the Cr by Zn. Now this solution you can get by matrix inversion. You can prove rigorously for the imaginary part of the positive, it is invertible. And you can get the matrix solution by just writing this small code. Now let's label this, this matrix, which is appeared here by this T symbol. So you can see as A minus K, when it's from 0, 1 till A minus 1, these are symmetrically placed weights. So this T actually is this coefficient matrix here, and I have this coefficient separate. So the same equation, 7, can be written in this form. This is M by M matrix. So this vector is this scattered field of this M number of sites. You can also play with it a bit more. You can express this vector with z as a complex variable, and then this kind of other sequence written as a raw polynomial vector, and this dot product you can generalize easily as summation of the u I at the size where I change the mass. Now, as m goes to infinity, which is the problem which we can tackle using complex analysis, this problem also, of course, we can treat it as solved, it is just one version of this matrix. But m going to infinity is a problem, it is a semi infinite effect problem. Where I'm changing the mass of the size from 0. Then, after infinity, separated by n. right there, you can see this dot product that just becomes a plus a part of the transform of some function u. And this u is something of just that discrete point, it's like a field at both sides where I change the mass. And similarly, I can apply this for the infinite gain contribution on the same side, and I have this function. And one can calculate this because we have the infinite given. And the question of this equation, say that it's a hybrid equation, solving this equation over now infinite number of unknowns, starting from 0, 1, to infinity. So this is now going to become a column vector of infinite number of unknowns. And this matrix also, P matrix becomes a matrix infinite in this direction. This problem is equivalent to a linear half equation. So the limit you can now directly tackle through the methods of complex analysis for this problem where it's a simple infinite sequence of masses where you have changed from 1 to 1 plus delta n. So here it is from y equal to 0, y equal to n, y equal to n. And I have infinite wave coming from the right side, and there will be a reflected wave, there will be also transmitted wave. I can ask a very simple question. So now, what is the reflection coefficient? What is the amplitude of the reflected wave given the reflected wave of unit amplitude? Simple question to be answered, and we have this problem setting, and we can apply rules of complex analysis. And put it up. So the complex analysis of short is this. I already mentioned u plus, so this is finding a sequence, in fact, a1, and you can take the contribution for the non negative part of it and the negative part of it. And using this particular definition of these functions, and assuming certain properties of their behavior as n goes to plus minus infinity, you can have a function which is going to be limited in some radius between r plus and r minus radius. Typically, we will have it including the limit circle. And we can also employ inverse Fourier transform for this definition, and that is, you can use a Fourier integral, and you can recover the coefficients or the unknown field on this. You apply this technique to this problem here, and I'll skip those details. You just have now the problem involving the scattered field at those sites where you have perturbed the mass and the corresponding counterpart in the negative direction integers. So this is the minus plus. The kernel L happens to be the ratio of two functions which are essentially contributing to the relation on the two parts. This A happens to be describing the dispersion relation for the perfect lattice, L0, without any mass effect. The numerator, A plus epsilon M, describes the dispersion relation. Or is related to the dispersion relation for the positive real line or those integers where you have regular arrangement of masses. This is also a typical coincidence with the second problem standing for the equation in both lattices and complex, continuum problems. One can solve this equation by using a technique. Factorizing this function L as a product of two factors, L plus L minus, and you can construct a solution for this U plus factor. This is a function that I indicated earlier. from this. And then the simplicity is just the same as in place. So you have exact solution for the scattered wavelength. Now, I can also make a remark about the connection between both problems. So this problem has n equal to infinity potential, so infinite number of particles that have changed the mass. Well, earlier I started with the finite number of particles that have changed the mass. And I have done this kind of analysis also for that problem and constraint problems on a finite number of sites, as well as finite number of parts in both and all. And there also we have this observation, which is based on these papers. So if you take the Fourier coefficients of this kernel L, if you have a kernel L, then you can find out by integrating this total integral that they are exactly describing this straight-lick matrix. If I truncate that matrix and take the northwest corner, n by n corner, it is exactly this matrix that I got here. And this is not a coincidence, this is a very well known theorem, the theory of the properties. And one can see this as an example of what is called the finite spectrum effect. Now, let me come to the illustrations of this problem. So, these are the incident waves. I'm taking seven number of sites as separation between. Particles that change the mass. So this is for the same infinite problem now. And this is just a cartoon showing it. This is 7, 7, 12, 12. Delta n is that small n. K is the substrate string constant. This is the frequency of the instant wave. This is the real number of the instant wave. These are just plots of how the instant wave looks like at a given instant. And the red one is the real part, this is the imaginary part. This is in the least satisfies the equations in this graph. Our goal is to find out the coefficient, reflection coefficient, for what goes back to the L0, which is the part on the left side of this picture. This is the dispersion curves with band gaps for all these four kinds of configuration, just the illustration on this. Choices, same choices, four of them. Now, this is n equal to 4, so 12, and the upper half is in the same. You can see that if you change the mass perturbation, it is 1 here, 0.8, 0.5, 0.1. This is the place you are not changing mass, and perturbed is unperturbed every mostly. The band gap is very small. And also, if you change pairs, it shifts up, that is all. Just increases the band gap from 0 and the power of the no, this is for infinite time, same infinite lattice problem. Yeah, this is, these curves are for, in fact, infinite lattice, where you have a mass perturbation with a perturbation occurring after every n. So n is different, 7. Yes, exactly. Thank you. So this is the curve which connects both sides. Now, you solve the problem, and here this solution is a numerical solution. And this is for the scattered field. You can see in this case there is some interesting field, and then it's not really very big, but this depends on the so here I have chosen, for example, in the first time here, 0.29, 0.49, 0.61, 0.82. So it depends on where they lie, and you may or may not have a nice wave which is going to go into the perturbed lattice. That way, the reflection wave will depend on that. Reflector wave will depend on that. So scattered wave field, the nature of it on the left and the right will depend on this. Total wave field also you can plot by adding. Now, the question about the reflected wave amplitude. So, that I can get from the solution. I have a complete reflected solution. here. I can just use expansion or this limit towards that point corresponding to that wave going back. And you can have some nothing that the CPU calculates relevant here. I just substitute the definition and simplify it in terms of the L expression, its factorization, and I can derive a closed form expression for the coefficients of the reflection here. That is PR. Now, considering the numerical solution, yes, it's tricky for these problems, but I took a large enough grid for an artificial problem. I took an PL kind of analog to the problem for the discrete problem, and this is summarized in the paper in the appendix. Now, the solution I will expect for the reflection coefficient. For these same problems, these four cases, these same parameters, I'm showing for all four plots. Here is n equal to 7, n equal to 4, 12, and 12. You can see there is, first, it's a band gap where you have a reflection coefficient 1. The wave that doesn't go to the other part, there will be an after that. And in between, it does have an interesting dependence, also as you increase the frequency. This is horizontal axis is a wave number, k. So frequency is going to increase in this direction typically. So you can have, for example, you can take a look at this. The incident wave is going to be chosen from this picture. So I start from here and go to this point. So you have resonances because you have a lattice on the positive web axis to be also a regular wave, right? It's not a random wave. But yes, as I made a note earlier, it's an interesting problem to study when it is also random. And you can also have random masses. Both are interesting questions in our analysis. Coming back to this solution, you can see that I have reduced the perturbation, mass perturbation, 1.8, 0.5, and 0.1. So this is where you have very small perturbation from the perfect level, L0. And you have mostly resonances happening here, very thin stop bands, and the curves seem to have some kind of behavior if you look at them. So you do get interesting questions arising from it, and as I said, it's an ongoing work. The real and imaginary part of the frequency from this complex reflection coefficient, and the gray is the numerical solution where there's the dynamical solution, just to show that it's a correct solution. The numerical solution agrees with the exact solution if you have got dynamically. Because in these kind of problems, you can make mistakes with a lot of symbols involved in complex analysis is really complex. So if you can down to something, okay. So then you can ask questions about canonical problems. How do you really formulate canonical problems with such simple articles? And if you look at the word canonical, there is some connection with religion, but then in blue, there is a question that says, how people have been trying to write something that is sensible. So you can see here, it's in mathematics, and the example is often used to be an archetype. Here it says, it is also used in mathematics, music, and can refer to something that is used to its most basic form. The reason why I mention this is because this one dimensional problem does capture the intersect of two things, which I have taught in the last decade, or last decade. So of course, in general, you can ask, in science, how do you say it is canonical? So you can ask to organize the conference. You can ask in the for the journal how do you think the minimalistic problems should be defined. You can take a vote for the art, and of course, it does come to personal choices. There is not really a complete set of canonical problems. So I discuss a model problem, and some features of it are indeed remembering or trying to refer to things that are observed in more complicated problems. I hope it connects to the problem. So yes, let me tell you a little bit about the published problem. So as you know, I'll give a very short 2 minute talk about history, because you will hear from some speakers from history and they might be giving you a very exciting profile. So this is a recommended race initiating the discussion plastic, if you like, here. Also there are two dynamical crystalline single edges as well. And going back to the studies of some machines, some experiments which were done in 1880s. And the problem, of course, was solving different maze coordinates, different coordinates, integral coordinations, and then take them in the top, a very strong case of solving such problems with classical geometry or different geometries. Of course, often they didn't solve it, but the solution played a role in finding, kicking off this entire pursuit of techniques to solve this problem. So, for example, you don't have to use to solve problems of the same kind of geometry you have to solve, subtract, you can say, the same kind of acoustics. These are exactly the same equations. And the single boundary conditions, you can the technique is so powerful you can solve many other problems of this type. So as we know, the opinion has moved on from its initial phase of being there for 10 or 10 years, and suddenly there is an application to solve major physics problems. I have posed the problems on lattices, and those you can make by discretizing the Laplace operator on a space. So you can have motivations of components, finding differences. You can have a motivation also of crystalline models, coming from actual observations. You can, if you visit in the lab where they have SEM or some kind of microscope, you can see the pictures where you have a little arrangement of particles with a bunch of spots, and you can see nice pictures illustrating that there is some kind of arrangement of particles in some of the lattices. And mathematically, these problems also have been solved going back to 1870s, in fact, where the next meeting has solved problems for propagating cracks in the twilight. And also, one in those and also solved problems on channel and different directions. You can also have association with physics from the point of view of thermal effects as well as from electronic and quantum effects. And it goes back to the work of the 1640s, where he was studying what I was referring to earlier, finding systems, contact longer problems where you have some perturbations, and typically find masses in the systems or vacancies, or diffuse sort of spread out defects. And there is a huge literature on that from the 1650s. What I did was pose the problem for a lattice, very simple problem, and have a lattice wave just similar to the wave that I discussed today for the one-dimensional problem, and let it contract with a crack. So, from the point of view of mechanics, this is a problem of anti-plane shear deformation from the acoustic level, or from the point of view of just layer out of plane displacement of particles that are connected to the various members. These are published for sky lattice as well as for triangular lattice and honeycomb. With honeycomb, the restriction was that it was a zigzag direction along which the crack was, or the interesting of the line. Then the problem has been solved also for infinite cracks in the strip, square lattice, and these are the problems where you will see direct connection with the problem that was presented today. So this is the model that is used in paper, where I have presented this on for these kinds of different conditions. This is black dots are the arithmetic condition, and gray ones are the normal form, let's say, of fraction field condition. And you have equations which are in two dimensions, but then because it's a finite weight along a wide axis, it's a quasi-one-dimensional problem, so a lot of things still have it. The one-dimensional calculation that I presented today. There are also problems that are solved with a collection of these spinning edges, and you the beauty of these solids is you can solve it by hand. Sometimes you may have a bad paper integral which you can still use simple code to solve and obtain the solution. And then there is a work with Gary, where we had studied a small zone which may have bonds of different nature, and see if you can carry over some of these techniques and also you can see the effect. So, yes, that is also a connection with this kind of problem. Problems where you have on the surface a composition between infinite and equivalently for eclipse, where you have these perturbations. These are quasi one dimensional, and you are also having a close connection with the formulating integral. Now, when you connect rigorously, nicely, the only problem with these, you are taking this system, it will be to answer. This problem I had worked with Victor in 2019, where we had a surface interface on the square lattice. And that problem is perhaps the closest to the problem I presented today, because the surface layer is essentially a 1D problem. And we got the results for waves which are moving across the interface between these two different kinds of layers. And we solve equations essentially on the boundary of the half space. And the exact solution you can get for this problem also can be from the finite space. And just recently, last year, I had worked on this problem, which was for a surface on the circular lattice model. Here also, you have a problem in which it's essentially a surface phenomenon. So you have an interface here as a track, and waves can go from the upper track face to the lower or lower to the upper. And you can ask the question, what is the coefficient of reflection for such an interaction? And that also you can get analytically. Let me show you how the thing looks like. This is for a physical behavior. So you can see it has a picture of this kind of injury. And this is connecting well the solution that we had earlier for the 1D problem. The minima of those precision decisions, they're also having the support them. So there seems to be some nice connection with this product where you have a dominating 1D effect. So at this point, I think I'll thank the institute where I'm coming from for supporting this research for more than a decade, and the third funding agencies, and the institute, which is providing me this opportunity for today from January to June, and support from the live program. Thank you for your attention.